This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, today I'm very happy to have with us Lee Harris. Well, many of you will know Lee's name, of course. He is a medium. He is a musician. He's an artist. He's a transformational leader. He is well known, and he has written a really lovely and empowering book called Energy Speaks, Messages from Spirit on Living, Loving, and Awakening. Last week, we explored the dark side of energy, and this week, we are going to explore a whole different vision. Lee Harris may be the most insightful, authentic, and caring empath I have met in a lifetime of seeking, says Mike Dooley, the author of Infinite Possibilities. Lee, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me on.
Well, it's a real pleasure to have you on. And gosh, in looking at the book and reading the book, I found it so, it's a wonderful book about abundance and joy and just being joyous in the world. And that's not my style, as all my listeners know. I'm a much darker soul. But that's okay. I need this as much as many of my listeners, I'm sure, do. Can you tell us a little bit about kind of what happened when you were 23?
Yeah. So when I was 23, I heard the voice of my guides. And I was on the tube, the London Underground train, going to work and sifting through all the negative thoughts in my brain at the time and all the things that I thought were wrong with my life. And from the left side of my head, which to this day is where I hear them, I heard this voice saying, "That's an interesting way of looking at it, but you're wrong." And it was very shocking at first and very strange because I'd never experienced a voice like this. But when I asked them some questions, they explained, "We're your guides. You just haven't been able to hear us. We've always been with you. But you haven't been able to hear us until today." And from that day forward, there's never been a time I can't talk to them. There are times I've chosen not to, but there is never a time that I can't just have a conversation with them.
They're always available, in other words.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, you were on the tube. You call them the Z's. What does that mean?
Well, when I asked them, do you have a name? They said, "Well, we don't have names. But we know that humans need names." So they said, "You can call me Zachary. That would be the best translation of a name." And then over the years, I met different members of this group. So they explained that there are a group of 88 who then extend wider into source energy. And the way I look at that is, I feel we are all connected anyway. So, it's like you can have 12 different friends and then you're connected to all of their friends through them. So while they do say that they are a group and they were able to give me some names for some of them, they also say that everything connects with everything. And they said, think of us as a consciousness library. They have access to different ideas, understandings, but they're not all necessarily the same in the group, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah. I can understand that differentiation. It makes a lot of sense. Let me ask you this. This is different from many such entities that I've heard of. Can a guide be like a single individual?
Well, interestingly, some of them have very strong single individual identities. And that's kind of those were the ones that I seem to have had the most contact with because they explained that we mirror you the most. But they did also caution me against seeing them as a single individual. And they also said, "Well, you're not really a single individual." They were like, "All of you as human beings, you're made up of so many voices and influences, and you have, you know, your good days and your bad days, and depending on where you're focused, you're actually quite multidimensional, but you're not trained to see yourselves that way. So while they agreed that, you know, some of them are much more individually focused than others, and they have more of a interface sounds very clinical, but they have more of an interface with what it is to be a human being. Others in the group apparently have not incarnated as a human being before, so they don't have quite the same understanding. They are more energetic in what they're doing in the collective. They aren't necessarily the spokespeople that I meet, who seem to have more of a connection point with me, if that makes sense.
Oh, yeah. It makes a lot of sense. And believe me, folks, as we go through this, this is going to make more and more sense, because I'm not like most interviewers. I read these books, and so I've got we're going to have a good time. And that's going to really start in earnest, Free Dreamlanders, when we get back. You know, the afterlife revolution is proving to be really a wonderful, wonderful book and experience for a lot of readers. There's 120 plus reviews on Amazon on the book, most of them 5-star, and I give it a 5-star review too. Guess why? Anne and I really wrote it together, and it's standing up in my life. I go back to it often, again and again, really, and I remember some of the wonderful things that she has said. From here, it looks like you are all intentionally ignoring us, which must be what it's like from the world of the dead. I know it is for her, because she's always knocking on my door and saying, listen to me. And, you know, you can get in touch with your own dead, with those who are interested in you too. The afterlife revolution is one way to do it. Another way to do it is to take to heart what's going on this lovely show this week with Lee Harris and Energy Speaks. It's all out there, folks, and it's real. Take advantage. Take action on your own behalf. Listening and waiting don't help. You gotta do something.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
We're talking to Lee Harris. His new book, Energy Speaks, Message from Spirit on Living, Loving, and Awakening. And we're going to work with all three of those ideas over the course of what I know is going to be a great conversation. Lee's website is leeharrisenergy.com. And you can go to leeharrisenergy.com and you can get a free access to a free gift from Lee by signing up for his newsletter, and get immediate access to something called the Elevate Your Abundance Package, which includes Surrender and Abundance, the Surrender and Abundance PDF. And I thought I would start by asking you about surrender, because it's so crucial to your thinking and your work and your discoveries.
It's interesting, isn't it? You know, we kind of, as human beings, we want to create things, and we want to have experiences, and we want to bring things to us, whether it's information or relationships or money. And yet at the same time, we have to surrender to the universe and the universe's will as much as our own. It's this co-creative relationship. So the article, the PDF Surrender to Abundance is really about that place in us of, do we surrender to abundance? So the example I like to give is, if your friend offers to buy you a coffee and a muffin, most of us will accept. Now, you might say, oh, thanks, that's great. You might say, oh, well, then I'll get the next one. Or you might say, no, I'll pay for myself. But if the friend were to offer you a holiday in Hawaii and offer to pay for the flights and the hotel for 2 weeks, and they say, and I'm going to take care of all our meals and all our outings, most of us wouldn't just go, oh, great, thanks. You know, we'd go, well, hang on a second, that's a lot of money, and no, I can't accept that. Or so I always use that example with people, because all that reveals is our own conditioning about what we will and won't receive from others. Now, to be fair, there is one thing I haven't mentioned there, which is sometimes you need to make sure that people aren't being generous beyond their means. You know, you might think, well, this friend is always generous, but she doesn't really have the money to buy me a coffee and a muffin, so I'm going to say no. But most of the time, we have very strict ideas of how abundance can come to us. We also can be blind to the abundance we already have in our life. The fact that, you know, we have access to running water and food every day is a very abundant reality compared to some people on the planet. So the article really is designed to get you to think and see your own places you aren't surrendering to abundance in your life. And that's why it's a free gift, because I know for me, abundance was something once I started to work with that energy in my life more, I really unlocked a lot more presence, actually, being able to be present and being able to remember there is a mystery at work here that I need to remain curious about. And if I'm ever stuck or down, some part of me has pulled back from the mystery. And that's okay, because we do that. But that's really why I kind of why I credit the Z's with helping me so much get out of my dark place in my teenage years.
You know, I'm sure a lot of my listeners would love to know what, if there's any way to make a connection like the one you made with the Z's. They just seem to have appeared in your life all of a sudden.
They do. I mean, the funny thing is, I look back now and I can see that seeds were being sown all along the way. So I kind of woke up to a different, how do I put it? I woke up around the age of 17. I was a compulsive eater. I had bulimia. I was taken to Weight Watchers age 10. But at the age of 16, something shifted for me and I started to feel happier and I lost 60 pounds. And that was the beginning of my spiritual awakening. And Whitley, I said it to you right before we came on the call, but thank you for Communion, because you were one of my pivotal books that showed me, I definitely believe what I'm reading in these books. There is far more than meets the eye or what I've been told. And so I went through this 3-4 year awakening. I did see a channeler. So in a way, I met him once and I was a little... I thought he was a lovely man and I thought it was wonderful, the session, but I was a little skeptical as to the actual channeling piece. I was thinking, well, maybe he's just intuitive. He doesn't need to close his eyes and put on a funny voice for me. You know, so even I had my skepticism, but for me, they just came through. Now, to answer your question, I absolutely believe we all can make contact, not necessarily with our guides, but with the highest part of ourself or our soul. So I always encourage people to, and anyone listening right now can do this. You can either, if you're, you know, pause the show or do this after the show, sit down with a piece of paper and a pen, or if you prefer computer, the keyboard, and just write, what does my soul want me to know today? It's a really nice open question. It's a great way to get started. And then just write the 2 or 3 sentences or paragraphs that you hear. And then after you've written it, you can sit back and read it and take it in. I've done this in workshops all over the world, and I've had people look at me horrified when I've told them we're about to channel. And I swear I've never had anybody unable to do this. So I really believe that we can all channel higher self, universal wisdom, The question is, are we willing to? And also, do we get worried about whether it's a guide or whether it's God or whether it's... And I say, don't worry about that stuff. Just see if the information is supportive and useful, and recognize that the power in the act is you being willing to reach for something beyond yourself that's going to help you.
It's a very interesting question, isn't it? Are we willing to?
And I'm not always, Whitley. You know, some people say, oh, you've got access to the Z's all the time. And I'm like, yeah. And I still, it's not even that I forget that. It's that there are certain lessons that I think I'm learning that I will go through alone for a couple of days or a few days. But then I also always remember that if I just sit down and write a few sentences, they're going to connect me to something wider and bigger, and something's going to move. So I think it's a choice.
Yeah, I think it's a choice. My sense of it is that we're kind of constantly making that choice.
Absolutely.
It's going on all the time. Now, you, when we're talking about things like guides, I always wonder, you know, what... When you mentioned that you did not notice them at first, and that's a big part of this, is noticing. And when you know, they began talking to you in the tube, and you know, you couldn't fail to notice them then. And in my case, they what happened in communion. Yeah. It'd take a real moron to not notice that. But so we noticed. But what about the listener who's saying, well, what about me? I don't hear any voice. I don't wake up in the middle of a spaceship or whatever it was, mm-hmm. full of visitors. But I'm here too. And I want something like this in my life.
Well, that's brilliant. That's a brilliant point, because I think I understand the part of our brain or our awareness that goes, oh, well, this isn't happening to me. But I don't know about you, Whitley, what it was like. It's been a long – I read the book about 20 years ago now. So, but for me, what was so interesting is many years after channeling, I remembered that as a child, I had one recurring dream. And the recurring dream was this. I would go – downstairs in the house that we lived in before I was 6 years old when we moved. And it would be the middle of the night, and I would walk into the living room, the lounge, and all I could hear was like static, like the static of a television. And I couldn't hear anything apart from this noise. And in the two corners facing me of the room, there was a man and a woman, and I remember the woman had what seemed like a very big white afro. They both had pale skin from what I remember, but she had her hands either side of her mouth, and she was speaking with a very big pronunciation. And over the other side, in the other corner, there was a man. I don't remember his hair, but I know that they seemed twinned to me somehow, these two. And he was doing the same thing, but I couldn't hear anything they were saying. And all I remember in this dream is all I could hear was static electricity and these two beings who were on the other end of the room trying to tell me something. And the weirdest thing is I feel like I blanked that dream for a long time. And so a couple things. Number one, I think that we're all having fairly supernatural or intuitive experiences all through our life. But if you are listening to this and you are somebody who says, yes, I really want to meet my guides, I would really set an intention for it. I would write it down on a piece of paper and say, I want to communicate with my higher self more regularly. And then let the time and some of your actions toward that start to happen. But honestly, what I do always encourage people to do is to just start writing a message for yourself every day. And if you are serious about wanting to connect with your guide, you will give it 30 days of writing to yourself for 30 days, just a few lines a day. And don't be too disappointed if at first the messages are just loving and supportive and they're not necessarily giving you a formula to build a rocket. Because at first what happens is they kind of calibrate you to a frequency of love and openness. But after that, you start to get a little bit more information. You get to ask more questions about what's going on. So like anything, you can practice your way into it. But people occasionally will say, well, how do I know I'm not making it up if I'm channeling? And I say, well, two things. Number one, you are making it up, because the very act of channeling is you being a co-creator, you being willing to sit there and write or sit there and bring something through for others. But secondly, to try not to worry too much about this idea that this has to be separate from you. Because if you are communing with an entity or with a guide or with an angelic, you're in connection. You're in connection with that being. So try not to separate it too much in your mind.
Okay, free Dreamlanders, I have good news and bad news. The good news is these are all terrific ideas that we're about to share with you. The bad news is you can't resubscribe to Unknown Country yet, because we're not quite finished with the new website. But when it does come along, you'll be able to subscribe again. We'll be right back.
Did you know that the Unknown Country newsletter is absolutely free and comes to you by email once a week? The newsletter has been published since 2000, and in all that time, not one subscriber has ever received a single piece of spam, because they were on our list. But what they have received, week in and week out, is the very latest from UnknownCountry.com, including a Dreamland preview and all the latest news. Go to UnknownCountry.com and sign up today. You owe it to yourself, and it's free.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
We're talking to Lee Harris today. Energy Speaks, Messages from Spirit on Living, Loving, and Awakening. His website is LeeHarrisEnergy.com. There's a lot you can do on his website. You can get involved with his newsletter, but Lee actually does a lot. Lee, could you tell us a little bit about what you do?
Yeah, you know, probably the most popular thing that I do each month is something called an energy update video. And I take about, you know, 15 minutes, sometimes longer each month, to try and give language to what's going on in the collective. And of course, like all of us, you know, I won't be for everybody. I won't resonate with everybody. But for the people who I am in service to, I do my best to explain what's going on this month. What are some of the themes that might be showing up energetically, psychologically, emotionally, and give a few tips as to how to deal with it. Because I found that even though I was very exploratory around metaphysics and self-growth, I would often sometimes go to some really high metaphysics teachers but not really know how to apply it. So that's why I do the energy update videos, to try and ground what we're experiencing energetically. I also do music, and music and channeling happened for me within a year of each other. I actually started composing and hearing music a year before I started hearing my guides. And yeah, there are many different things that we do on the website. You know, we have MP3s, we have a how to channel audio guide. I feel grateful to be able to do this work. And so, I keep myself moving, as we all have to right now.
You know, we live in a world which is fundamentally disempowering. This is a place that tells you, first of all, that you're a meat puppet. That tells you that everywhere you look. Even if that's not what they're saying, that's what it's telling us, because of the vivid intensity of the material world around us, which is now in history very radically different from what it was in even the recent past. A person from 1955, and I was very aware and conscious in 1955, I was a 10-year-old boy, would not recognize this world. When I look back, what I chiefly remember is the quiet. This world is incredibly noisy and full of color and light and all kinds of things happening, and an seemingly unending number of choices mixed in with all kinds of bizarre lies that can turn you into a complete lunatic, even though that's not what you are. So how do we navigate all of this, Lee? I can tell by your tone of voice that you navigate it very well. I want to know your secret.
Oh, you know, I mean, like everyone, I definitely have had my ups and downs, and I have my ups and downs. I honestly feel that for me, doing the work I do serves me very well. So, you know, the energy updates I've done for 7 years, and it's good medicine for me to be having those conversations with people. But honestly, one of the things that the Z's said to me many years ago that I'm sure many listening will resonate with is they said, you have a foot in two worlds, and that can make being on Earth very tricky. And so I definitely love the magic and the wonder that can happen on Earth, and I can be heartbroken by the suffering and the shadow and the darkness. And what I have found for myself is if I keep leaning into, how do I put it, smaller focuses, I do better. So, for example, as someone who is a visionary, I used to be very big vision in the past, but I wasn't so good at taking care of the smaller stuff, the day-to-day. So I just identified where one of my weak links was and started to recognize I needed to focus on taking care of my physical self more every day. So I do go and exercise every morning, which, you know, I certainly wasn't running to many years ago, but it's like anything, you start to ingrain a new pattern in your life. So I think the only secret for any of us is figuring out what works for us and what we need, because we are all different in our needs, and then applying those as much as you can and staying peaceful. You know, I live in Malibu, which is fairly peaceful, and yet this morning I had to go into LA, and it was very busy in there, very crazy in there. I had to go in there for work, and I was very glad to come here, but I was thinking, yeah, that level of electrical energy would not serve me. So I've always chosen quiet places to live over the last decade or so, and that has helped me.
What did you, folks, if you will remember, there were terrible fires in Malibu a few months ago, and I happened to have a lot of friends in Malibu, Lee, and some of them were completely burned out, and I'm just wondering how you felt and what you did during that period.
Yeah, it was, I'd never been through fires before. So, you know, I get this evacuation warning and, you know, my partner had just gone off to work and we have two cats. So I bundled them into the car. I didn't even think about staying behind because I didn't realize it was an option. And of course, once you left, they didn't let you back in, but I didn't think anything was going to happen. You know, there have been warnings before. It was very interesting. I remember driving to my friends in Montecito, and there was ash falling on the car. There was smoke. It was very, very intense. But as it was happening, I had this very strong awareness that this was the kind of thing that the Z's have talked about for this period of history. They said there's a lot of light hitting the planet, but there's going to be a lot of destruction as well. And that doesn't mean to me that everyone's going to go through a wildfire or something environmental like that. But for me, it was, the lesson was, you know, there was no cell phone reception. I didn't quite know where to go. I've got two cats. I'm like, how do I? But I figured it out, and I just followed my intuition, and I drove in the direction no one else was driving. And then I realized I was driving more into the fire, but it felt like the right choice. And then a message came from my friend saying, yes, come to Santa Barbara. So that was the day of it. But I think the heartbreak in the area was really strong. And I feel like in the last few weeks, things have got better. But, you know, we're surrounded by missing houses. We were lucky that ours didn't go. But I have a friend, actually, Lee McCloskey, who lives not too far away from here.
How strange. Lee is one of my closest friends.
Oh, God, I had no idea.
Yeah,
oh,
I didn't either. I had no idea you even knew him.
Yeah.
How incredible.
Okay. Well,
yeah, I've been going to the Tuesday night group every week for years.
I was just going to share that he and Carla really inspired me with the posts they were sharing about what they went through. But when I drove to their neighborhood, exactly as Lee said, they're now living in a dead zone. You know, most of the houses
are gone. But you know, the fire stopped 150 feet from Lee and Carla's house. And folks, you don't know who Lee and Carla McCloskey are, but look up Olandar Foundation, Olandar Foundation on the internet, and you will see this extraordinary place. Lee and Carla are among the most marvelous people I've ever known in my life. Lee is a very, very knowledgeable alchemist. He is a close friend with a mutual friend, Prince Dirola, known as Stash to us as his nickname, who is also one of the great alchemists of this world. And we meet at his house on Tuesday nights. And incidentally, if you're interested in going, just write whitley@strieber.com, and I can certainly arrange for you to come. It doesn't cost anything, and it is all I can warn you is it's a very intense intellectual journey. Anyway, there was a lot of magic done around Lee and Carla at this apartment where I am. We created an energy dome around the house.
Uh-huh.
And Lee, interestingly enough, noticed it. You know, we were out of communication. We couldn't talk on the phone or anything. And he noticed the energy dome there. And then I left my body at one point and went up to the house to try to do what I could and just to be there in spirit, willing the fire to stay away. And I wasn't the only one that, because it's a very precious place, folks. If you go there, you'll know what I mean.
Yes.
I was not the only one working on behalf of Olandar and Lee and Carla, and they were working, boy. I helped to get a group of us actually helped to get the boat convoys started up to Zuma Beach because the police wouldn't let anyone in or out. The city had pulled back the fire department, so they were just sitting there, not mm-hmm. helping anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wanted to save your house, you had to do it on your own.
Completely.
Right. And so people were calling for help. And, you know, we got these boats going. And once one or two boats started, a lot of people started taking supplies up there. What a time. And you were right in the middle of it.
Well, we were just outside it. And then we couldn't get back in for about, I think it was 16 days later.
16 days. That's
in.
Right.
Yeah. 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 And it took a long time for the air to normalize or you know,
it
lighten
did.
Up.
And the water was gray for weeks.
Completely. So luckily, people like Lee and Carla that stayed behind, most of them were okay. I know of a few people who got deeply, deeply sick because they were here breathing the ash, defending their homes.
Yeah. Listen, Free Dreamlanders, we have a break here for a couple of minutes, and as always, I insist that you at least listen or pretend to listen to these commercials.
Are you a close encounter witness? There's a new organization for you called the Foundation for Research into Extraterrestrial Encounters. It fights prejudice, offers information, and a resource for those struggling in secret with their experiences. Its board of directors includes Edgar Mitchell, Whitley Strieber, Barbara Lamb, Mary Rodwell, and many others. Take the Experiencer survey at experiencer.co. That's experiencer.co. The foundation accepts donations, but its services are free.
This is Whitley Strieber, two of my legendary and long out-of-print books, The Path and The Communion Letters, edited by Ann Strieber, have been republished in ebook format. You can get them wherever ebooks are sold, at Amazon, at Barnes & Noble, at Kobo, at Apple Books. These are identical to the original print editions and for sale at $3.99 each. So if you have an interest in these subjects and you've been hesitant because of the extremely high price used booksellers want for the print editions of these books, now you can get them for a very reasonable price. And I can assure you, The Path is a remarkable reimagining or a recovery of an ancient system of the tarot that has become central to my own life journey, while The Communion Letters take a look inside the close encounter experience in the words of the people who have it in ways that nobody, but nobody in the UFO community would ever have let you see if it hadn't been for Ann Strieber, who edited these letters and chose them with an open mind and an open heart. The Path, The Communion Letters, everywhere ebooks are sold, $3.99.
Okay, we're back. Lee and I have discovered that we have close mutual friends, dear friends, Lee McCloskey and Carla McCloskey, and he lives in Malibu. Now, I want to get a little bit into empowerment here, because this is vitally important now. Since we've been talking about events, as it were, news events related, in fact, to climate change, in this case, a terrible fire that was much worse than it should normally have ever been. Why is channeling important now? What does channeling have to do with this world that we live in?
Well, I think, you know, it's interesting because for those of us who perhaps have known channeling for a long time, it's always been a part of our world. But I do think there is something in the mainstream is changing, not just around channeling, but you see awareness, mindfulness, spirituality, emotional intelligence, and things like intuition or channeling becoming much more commonplace. And it seems to me that there is the same spiritual hunger, perhaps, that those of us who had our awakening many years ago had, or that drove us into our spiritual opening, is happening for more and more people. Because the more absurd things get in 3D reality, the more people can clearly see that the system that we're in is not serving not just the world, but their own individual path. So for me, I think channeling is becoming a little more normalized and a little more sought out because people are wanting to connect with something that is intuitive and a voice that speaks from inside them in order to try and counterbalance, as you said, Whitley, all the noisy voices outside that are now competing for our attention. And I think that's where channeling is important because whether you are someone who channels your guides or just takes 5-10 minutes to sit with yourself quietly several times a day and let all the outer voices calm down and connect to what your inner voice is telling you, whether that's in words or just how you feel, we need to reset. One of the things that the Z's said is that our bodies have nothing in our ancestry to help us deal with the time like this on Earth. There is nothing in the memory codes of our body to deal with this kind of time. And so for me, channeling is a way of connecting deeply to yourself.
Well, yeah. And what would you say to someone who says, okay, I want to channel. Well, what do I do?
I would say kind of what I was saying earlier. I really would just sit down with pen and paper or keyboard and start by, for 30 days, asking yourself the question, what does my soul want to tell me today? Or what does my soul want me to hear today? And then just allow yourself to see if you can hear something. And you might hear a really simple sentence. You might hear, I love you, and you're doing really well. And you might think, oh, well, that's not very interesting. That didn't really give me any useful. But like I said, sometimes, you know, I always say to people, well, do you speak to yourself like that all day long? Because I know I didn't when I started channeling. So when they were kind of loving or kind, I knew that something new was happening for me. So that calibrates you to the frequency of channeling and the frequency of your soul. And from that point on, you can start asking more questions. So if you start to get good at it and it starts to get something you're used to, then you might start asking other questions. You might say, what do I do about this conversation I just had with my sister? And then see what comes.
You know, there's a lot of lovely material in the book, but one of the things that seems to follow from this, what we've just been talking about, is the eye of awareness. And I wonder if you couldn't tell us about your discovery of the eye of awareness and what it means.
It's interesting. That channel was 2007 now, and that chapter was not supposed to be in the book, but I was visiting a friend last June when we were right up against our manuscript deadline, and I had self-published some of these chapters in previous years, but we have, you know, since re-edited them and added all these new chapters too. And he was saying, oh my God, I just love the eye of awareness in that book. And I was like, oh. So we quickly dusted it off. It's all about the idea that we often speak about intuition or consciousness, and we see it as a personal thing. But what the channel is talking about is that there is a third eye in the universe that we all connect to, and that when we are intuitive, it's not just our own intuition, our own third eye that we are accessing. It is the universal third eye. And so the chapter talks about that in some detail and also walks you through an exercise to connect to it. I'm glad that we kept that chapter in there, because when I first heard that concept, it made a lot of sense to me. And I did go to Google after the channel had been delivered, and I Googled the Eye of Awareness because I wanted to see if that title existed, because I thought, oh, I'm going to release this as a recording. And something about an Eskimo, a very ancient Eskimo piece of folklore was all about this Eye of Awareness. So I thought that was interesting. I always enjoyed that in the early days, that anything that would come through me that I'd not heard of, that if I then found some other source out there that was also backing it up, that was always very confirming for me of the idea that there's just one of us here, really.
Yeah, I can certainly understand that, because one of the things that we have trouble with is confirmation and affirmation, because as we discussed earlier, we are sort of overwhelmed in this culture with denial of ourselves and our true inner nature. And, you know, that kind of gets me into another direction, which is also covered very beautifully in the book, which is fear. We live in a world full of fear. I mean, you know, we were just talking about Leon Carla and Malibu. I lived in terrible fear at that time, but it was nothing compared to the fear of people who lost their homes. I know some people who lost everything. Mm. And I'm with them all the time, and they're living the loss of everything.
Yeah.
And, you know, we have, just in the past few months, horrific flooding across the middle of the United States, cyclones after cyclone hitting Australia, a terrible disaster in Africa, almost unimaginably huge, where a whole country has been turned into an inland sea by a massive cyclone, all of that. And then, you know, we have a lot of people who keep saying they don't believe in these climate changes and things. And I look at my grandchildren, and Lee, I feel fear.
Yeah.
What do we do with that?
Well, I've been there. I remember seeing a movie, a couple of movies. I saw a movie called Zeitgeist on the internet in 2008, and I saw Thrive in 2011, which spoke about some of these bigger concepts. And I definitely, after seeing Zeitgeist, felt a lot of fear for a while, just about humanity, the world itself. There's two things, really. The Z's talk about this transformational time, and they say it's understandable that there will be fear. But one thing they've always said to me is that they have said that we get co-opted into fear. So there are certain agendas on the planet that it would greatly help if we were all very scared about certain things. They said, and that fear can be used to push things through. So I'm aware that fear is real and that we all have it. And so it's not that you can deny it. But what I've started to lean into myself that works for me is when fear turns into worry or anxiety, there's nothing you can really do. And if you are able to notice your fear, see it come up, feel it come up, recognize that's part of the plan, but also come back to the small focus in that moment. And the one thing the Z's have said for years, and they've said, you can all die anytime. And they kept saying it over and over and over again at public event after public event. And one day I was like, God, you know, this is, why do you keep saying that? Because it triggers people. But they were saying, when you understand and you remember that, anything that's going on the planet that you're very attached to starts to loosen. And you start to understand that everything is bigger than you. And certain things are none of your business. It's not that you can't want to help people. It's not that you can't become an activist in certain areas. But that if we are just in reaction or recoil to what is happening, we're not going to be very useful. But we're also forgetting that this is the time of history that we elected to be in. So I say all of that not because I think that that's going to make everybody feel comfortable, but those are some of the ways of seeing and feeling about things that I have used to help me at times, and they have worked for me even when I'm, you know, driving with ash falling on the car and I'm definitely adrenalized, there's no question. But there is another part of me that can kind of keep my awareness on a bigger view, a bigger picture, and also to not be deceived into thinking that those kinds of things can't happen any day. You know, I think if you live from a place of, well, we have today and we don't know what tomorrow brings, there is an empowerment in that, but usually we have to go through grief to get to that place. And I know for me, I've had several big, big grief periods in my life that definitely cleared out a certain amount of my more base emotions around grief.
Well, you know, the Buddhists have the idea of remembering from moment to moment, always, that you will die. In our culture, we don't think about that. That's something that will happen tomorrow until suddenly it does happen to someone you love. And so I think the Z's were offering a really good stone to step on the journey, spiritual journey, because the truth is we think, oh, how awful to always be morbidly thinking of realizing I'm going to die, could die the next minute. It's incredibly freeing. It leads to such peace. It's a wonderful state, actually.
It is. And I also try and remember to zoom out a lot. So, for example, people who were on the planet, you even gave the example of 1955. I mean, a lot of people who were on the planet in 1955 aren't here anymore. But let's go back further and think of people who were living in 1900. Not only what would they think of this time, but if you think they had seemingly a long life, and let's say they had a long life, you know, they had many experiences, but it's kind of the blink of an eye in terms of human history. So that's the piece that kind of, you know, I try and remind myself in moments of kind of mental stress or emotional stress to just kind of zoom out a little bit. And actually, that's what channeling has done for me. It's always been the way that I have been able to get a bigger view of it than perhaps what my smaller thoughts or feelings are processing at that time. Doesn't stop you having those thoughts or feelings, but it can help to open you beyond them.
We have the potential to have a greater awareness. You call it the infinite you. I turn toward the eye of awareness, the conscious light of clarity that is my powerful ally. I open to this radiant light that penetrates all confusion and darkness, illuminating the path to my highest good and greatest experience of life. Okay, Lee, I want to ask you if you can tell us how to experience that beautiful state.
Well, for me, that state has been mostly accessed through channeling. I have had other spiritual experiences when I wasn't channeling that kind of gave me that state. But I also feel like this is where I'm a student of the book. That's channeled material. Those are channeled words. Those are channeled invitations. And so for me, the channeling state has, I would say, raised my feeling and intuition level more than anything else in my life. So that's the best advice I can give. So it's kind of going back to what I've said, which is try the 30-day challenge of writing to yourself from your higher self every day, because like anything, practice rewires us. Practice creates a new pattern. It creates a new relationship. And so that's what I would suggest.
Now, my wife passed away in 2015, and I've lived in a state of what I would describe as accepting grief ever since. But I've also lived with my wife, who is very much a part of my life now, and especially recently, because I'm working on a project that involves her, and boy, is she interested. She's here. And can she be a guide to me? Because she seems like a guide.
Oh, you know what's funny? As you were saying all that, I was just hearing she's not leaving you. She's very attached to you in the most beautiful way.
Yeah, and it's she funny sure is.
Very devoted to you. And what I get about her is she's fiery and loving, a bit of a tough customer too. You know,
you're getting that
she
right.
She wasn't always easy, but she was powerfully loving. And she was very devoted to you, even though she wouldn't just always, she certainly wouldn't always just placate you, but she dearly loved you. And she also was very, what I get is she was very committed to your work. I feel like she understood what you stood for on the planet and your role, perhaps sometimes even more than you did, because she was able to stand back and see it. And she was a help to you with those times where understandably that had been a burden or that you just didn't want that responsibility. And so whatever it is that you're doing now, it has a mastery energy to it. And so she really wants to be involved in much the same way that she would have been if she was still here. But she also feels excited for you and loves you and wants to be in on that too, the good stuff.
You know, interestingly enough, folks, I am going to read to you from a text exchange with a writer who is working on a project about our life, my life and Anne's life, from about an hour and a half ago. He was asking me about Anne, and I wrote this. She was intellectually the lead. She found the meaning. She figured things out. She was also the interpreter. Her insight was tremendous. She was the first person, I think, who ever came even close to understanding this whole thing. That's why she and Jacques Vallée were such friends. She understood his work deeply and mine. So you picked up on exactly, precisely, I mean, almost word for word. You really are very, very sensitive. That's great.
Oh, thank well, no. So it was lovely to feel her and to feel your connection. And you know, I'll just say this: I, you know, you and I didn't really speak at all before this show, but I got
Not
to
at
tell
all.
You, I got to tell you, thank you for communion. And I don't really know what it was like for you, Whitley, but I can only imagine how hard it was. And so, just in terms of dealing with the public side of all of that, I'm glad that you had her. I'm glad that she was able to be there for you to support you through that.
You know, I'm a person who does not get mad. I can count on the fingers of one hand. In fact, even just maybe one finger, two, the times I've been really angry in let's say the past 25 years, it just isn't in me. But Anne did it for me. She had a big temper, and it was, and she could, you know, it was a relief much to express it. Now, you're a light worker. I want to go back to this. This is such a rich experience, this conversation, Lee. I want to thank you for it. I want to just also mention again, his book is Energy Speaks, Messages from Spirit on Living, Loving, and Awakening. And you can get to him at leeharrisenergy.com. Now, a light worker is it's a person who works in light. And I've heard that word many times, never really understood it. Can you tell us what your vision of a light worker is?
Yes, so it's a term that I didn't really use, or I mean, the Z's would use it, and I would hear other people in groups talk about it, and it became like this thing, light workers. And from my perspective, a light worker is anybody who is helping to raise the energy, the love, or the frequency in a room. Or if not just a room, perhaps they have created some kind of organization that's helping tens or hundreds or thousands of people in the world. And they did it because they wanted to make the world or the world a better place, or those people have a better experience. So there is a conscious intent to create a better place or a better atmosphere or a better experience for the person in front of you or the millions of people in front of you. The tricky thing with light workers is, of course, there are millions of them everywhere who would never even identify with that word, but they're the people who, you know, that's the nurse that loves you very dearly when you're recovering from an operation, and she barely knows you, but she just unconditionally loves you through it, or he does. But there are those on the planet who are very aware of their mission, who have some sense that they're here to help humanity. And the problem with that is twofold. It can, number one, feel like a hell of a responsibility. But number two, our minds can distort it. You know, sometimes you see people with big egos because they're light workers. And, you know, you have to feel for them because they've just kind of got lost in this idea of specialness, which, of course, is never rooted in feeling special. It's always rooted in feeling less than. But equally, there are other people who think they have to write a book or start a movement because they're a light worker. And actually, the truth is, we're all needed, whether you're somebody who affects 10 people or, you know, a million people. It doesn't really matter. That's just a numbers game. But light workers are the people on the planet who help generate light, love, peace where they go. And it doesn't mean you have to be a perfect person. You'll still be a human being. We've all got our stuff. We've all got the things that we're working on as humans. But that's really the hallmark of a light worker.
Now, one of the things that has been most important in my life with the visitors, and in fact central to it, has been sex energy. It has been kundalini and a number of different forms. I, in fact, learned about kundalini from the visitors because I didn't really know much about it. I'm sexually a very proper, old-fashioned guy, and I'm not an experimenter, and I've only had one partner in my life, my wife, and but except for them, of course, that is another story entirely. And she was completely cool with that. It didn't, I was so humiliated and ashamed when I told her about it, and she she just looked on it as a really valuable experience.
Yeah.
She had a lot of insight, and you do too. Why, what is, tell us about your vision of sexuality in spiritual work.
Well, the breakthrough for me came when I understood that sexual energy and creative energy are one and the same. That sounds strange in some ways, but in another way, it's complete makes sense. You know, if you think that it's the act of sex that creates a human baby, or certainly not always, as we know, but that definitely is part of it. And so, what the Z's would talk to me about is they would say, "Well, sexual energy is happening everywhere." And I'd be like, "Well, what do you mean?" And they said, "Well, if you go for coffee with someone and it's a friend of yours and you hug them, or you're just happy to see them and they're happy to see you, even if they are not the gender that you would sleep with, or you would never think of wanting to sleep with them," they say there is a certain sexual energy that's happening, because sexual energy at its purest is simply a chemical and connective energy between beings that can be combined to create something bigger than the individual. So in the act of sex, two people or more come together and they create something through their combination that creates an energy reaction in their body. Same if you're, you know, being sexual by yourself. But what they really explained was how sexual energy is at work everywhere as a life force on the planet. Part of the reason that we have been taught shame and segmentation around sex on our planet is to keep us from it, because it is a very powerful and magical energy. But like any powerful and magical energy, titillation or escapism are not really hallmarks of it. So part of the way that you keep it very separate in society is to create a shame around it and to only give it one face, which is, you know, oh, sex is this. Whereas actually sex is very healing energy. And even if you're someone who abstains from having sex with other people, your sexual energy is running through your body all of the time. And it's a very creational energy. So it's often why artists if they're painting or if they're creating something or whatever it is that you like to create, whether it's your garden or your kitchen, you get lost in the energy of it for hours because you don't need anything else. You are satiated by that energy that is running through your system while you're creating. And that's very similar to a good sexual experience. You forget time. Everything disappears. So I knew that that chapter had to be in the book because that's one of the recordings from the Z's that has been the most popular thing I've ever done.
Well, I can well understand it because it's so important. This is not a long book, folks. It's very tightly written, and it's more of a doorway. You know, and it's a doorway into the work of a man who is going down a really lovely, in my opinion, path. And for example, there's not all many channels are really willing to talk about sexual energy and things like that because of the social norms in which we live. But we're coming up toward the end of the show, and I would like to end it with something that I think is really very important, which is one of the things that holds us down and it prevents us from finding the lightness of being that is really what we are and who we are, is wounding, and in particular, the sexual wound. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Well, yeah, it's interesting. I'm just trying to decide which way to go with this, personal or universal. Well, let's go universal. So the sexual wound is really about connection and pleasure, and connection with others. And I just mean platonic connection. I don't even mean sexual connection, and our pleasure and our ability to be open and surrendered and receiving, that allows us to be a conduit of energy. So when we're in that state, more energy can come into and through us, and then we give that energy out. So sexual wounds on the planet, and boy, are we seeing this at the moment. It's really it's really in focus with everything that's going on, not just around the Me Too movement, but so many other topics of conversation that are very shadowy and difficult and are rising to the surface. It's a place where it feels to me, certainly looking on, that as human beings, power and enslavement have happened towards one another. It's almost like there's this very shadowy energy that wraps around sexual interactions and sexual energy, and yet that's such a place of potency. And again, you might choose to be celibate. It's not about the act of sex, but it really leads back into our pleasure and our connection with one another. And yet so many of us have these wounds around sexuality because we were taught to shame and fear it. So that's the first thing that comes to me. And then for myself, just in my personal journey, I had a lot of shame in my young years because I realized that I wasn't heterosexual, and I could see that that was going to be a problem because that's what the rest of the world told me. So I think, you know, depending on whichever group you speak to, whoever you are, whether you're heterosexual or gay or trans or, you know, any of the groups, we have such a shame around sex in the same way we have really heavy energy around money on the planet. And they are power energies on the planet. And yet they are energies that we have been asked to not fully own our power in. And so that's why I think the Z's will talk about our sexual wounds as much as our emotional wounds. They don't talk about it very much, but in Sex and Sexual Energy, they talk about it in that chapter.
You know, Annie comes in every once in a while during these sessions, not all of them, but she did just now, and she has something to add. She says, sex, or rather climax, is the way God always feels. That's why we're here. Hmm. So that incredible intensity of energy. And she's also spoken in the past about the yearning that is basis of consciousness and the basis of reality. And, you know, Lee, it's been a beautiful conversation, and I want to thank you for spending time with us on Dreamland. Energy Speaks. It's obviously a lovely book. LeeHarrisEnergy.com. Lee is really well worth exploring. If you're on a journey, or especially if you're on in a rocky place or a hard place or a dark place, probably be a darn good place to go. So, Lee, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.